The chemical level of organization, we have to start with matter. We know the definitions, we'll go briefly through them. The matter is anything that occupies space and has volume is called matter, and mass is the quantity of matter in a thing is called in a body is called mass. Weight is actually different. It is the force of attraction of the earth on the on a body, on a mass, is called weight. And then we have elements and atoms. We know all the matters, either gases, liquids, solids, they are made up of atoms. And how we define atom? Atom is the smallest stable unit of matter that have all the characteristic of a matter is called atom. And we know the atom is made up of electron, proton and neutron mainly, and there are various subatomic particles other than these. We know there are about 110 plus elements in the universe, but the discovered so far, but in human body there are about 26 elements present. So the elements, how we define them, they are made up of atoms, and the elements, they are made up of same kind of atoms. And the four elements, that is carbon, hydrogen, oxygen and nitrogen, they make about 95% of body weight of human being. And 13 elements, they make about 99% of body weight. It means the other 13, total are 26, the other 13 are less than 1% of the body weight. Then we know the atomic structure. We are not going into detail. What is the atomic number? Atomic number is actually the number of protons in an atom, and the atomic mass is the number of proton and neutron in the nucleus of an atom. Then we have isotopes. We are familiar with the isotopes. No? Isotopes are variants of same elements that have different same atomic number but different atomic masses due to different number of neutrons in their nuclei. So the atoms that have different number of neutrons in their nuclei, they are called as isotopes when they belong to same element. So we know very well about these, like hydrogen have different isotopes, carbon has isotopes, and sometimes these isotopes, they are radioactive, they emit radiations. The chemical bonds, they can be defined as the gain, loss or sharing of electron between atoms to fill outer shells or valence shell to get stability. And these chemical bonds, they could be ionic, they could be covalent, and covalent, they could be polar and non-polar bonds. We are well familiar with these bonds. We are familiar with the valence shell or the outer shell and valency. Valency is the number of electrons an atom wants to gain or lose or to share to fill outer shell. So the ions, they are defined as atoms or molecules carrying a charge. That charge could be due to loss or gain of electrons. If it is due to loss of electrons, then positive charges appear on the atoms, and these atoms now called as cations. And if they gain electron, because electron are negative in charge, so these atoms, they become negatively charged and they are called as anion. So when an atom loses electrons, they are gained by another atom. One of them that lost electron become cation positively charged, and that gain electron become negatively charged. They are two independent atoms, but they have electrostatic forces between them that attract them together, and they start to live together. So that bond is called as an ionic bond, in which the electrons, they are completely donated from one atom to another atom. So they are not shared. They are weak bonds, and they are easily dissolved or broken when they, for example, the sodium chloride. The sodium is a cation that gives an electron to chloride and chlorine, and so they are staying together due to electrostatic forces. And when we dissolve them in water, they are easily dissolved. So the ions, they are the ionic bonds, they are weaker bonds. However, the covalent bonds, they are strong bonds, and there is no gain or loss of electron, or there is no complete donation of electron from one atom to another. It is only sharing. So the two atoms, they share their valence electron in their valence shells, and the electron, sometimes they are equally shared, mean none of the atoms is attracting electron more than the other, then they are called as at that time they are called as non-polar bond, covalent bond, because the electron are equally shared. And you know negativity and electropositivity of the elements. And if one of the atom attracts shared electron more as compared to the other, then this bond becomes, or this molecule become a polar molecule, because the negative charges, they are attracted to one atom, so they are called as polar. And again, it is due to electronegativity and electropositivity of the elements. Electropositive is an element that tend to lose electron to become a positive ion, and an electronegative is an element that tend to attract electron to become negative ion. So these elements, they, for example, the elements like the chlorine, it is electronegative because it has tendency to attract electron, and sodium is electropositive because it has tendency to lose electron. But in case of covalent bond, the electronegative, it attracts electron that are shared between the two atoms, and that electronegative has partial negative charges, and the electropositive has partial positive charges. For example, in case of water, it is the hydrogen linked to oxygen. Two hydrogen atoms are linked to oxygen, so oxygen is more electro negative, so it attracts electron on it, and the oxygen become electro negative, and hydrogens, they become negative, positive, partial positive. The oxygen, they have partial negative charges, and hydrogens, they have partial negative charges. That is a polar bond. In case of non-polar bond, the electron, they are equally shared. The elements, they are not attracting. For example, in case of carbon dioxide, the carbon and oxygen, they are equally electronegative, so they are sharing electron equally. So we said ionic bonds, they are weakest, and the covalent bond, they are strong. And in covalent bond, the non-polar bonds, they are strongest, and in case of human body, there are more the non-polar bonds. and the polar bond, they are stronger than ionic bond, but they are weaker than non-polar bonds. There is another bond that is called as hydrogen bonds. They are very weak bond, and they are, for example, in case of water, the hydrogen of hydronium ions of one water molecule, they are attracted to the oxygen oxygen atom of another water molecule. So they are very weak bonds. They are just force of attraction, and they are just to maintain surface tension of the water, and they provide very slow evaporation of water. So for example, in case of proteins and DNA folds, there are these bonds between the atoms of hydrogen and oxygen. So as we saw previously, substances, they could be anything, element, compound, molecule, anything, that is called as a substance. Element, we said, are the matters that are made up of same type of atoms. And the compounds, they are made up of different types of atoms. They are matters that are made up of different types of matters. And then there is another distinction, that is between molecules and compounds. The molecules, mostly they are the molecules, they are again made up of same type of atoms that are held together by a chemical bond, and the compounds, they are made up of different types of elements, and again the atoms are held by bonds. Solubility is the ability of a solute to get dissolved in a solvent. And dissociation is the measure of how much of compound splits into its ionized forms. So the ionic compounds, when they are dissolved in solvent, they may dissociate into their ions. And electrolyte is a substance that produces an electrically conducting solution when dissolved in a polar solvent. The dissolved electrolyte separates into cations and anions, which disperse uniformly through the solvent. Electrically, such a solution is neutral, but if we apply an electrical potential voltage to such a solution, the cations of the solution are drawn to the electrodes that have an abundance of electrons, while the anions are drawn to electrode that has a deficit of electrons. So the movement of anions and cations in opposite direction within the solution result in a current. So current actually is the passage of charges. Chemical reactions are defined as processes that involve rearrangement of the molecules or ionic structure of the substances. We can say these are processes that change chemical properties of the substances. So we know in a chemical reaction there are substances that combine together, they are called as reactant, that are broken down, they are called as reactants, and the end of this chemical reaction or process are the products that we gain. So in a chemical reaction, the bonds either are formed, or they are broken, or they are rearranged to change the chemical properties of the substances involved. These chemical reactions, they could be synthesis reactions. Synthesis reaction means combination reaction that make larger molecules from smaller, and they are mostly dehydrative reactions, meaning water is released from the substances and to make larger molecules. So they are sometimes called as anabolic reaction in body. Anabolic means building up. So they make they synthesize new things, for example synthesis of proteins, DNA from nucleotides, the larger molecules like polysaccharides from monosaccharides. They all are anabolic reactions, synthesis reactions, or they are dehydrating reactions. Then we have decomposition reactions that are to break down larger molecules into smaller molecules or into atoms, and they are they are hydrolysis reaction most time. Most of the time, water enters into the larger molecules and hydrolyze that molecule into smaller. So they are, these reactions, they are called as catabolic reactions. Catabolic mean breaking down. Cata mean break. And they are, for example, the breakage of fats, sugar, proteins into smaller substances. And most of these reactions, they are exergonic, mean they release heat. And the anabolic reaction or synthesis reaction, they are endergonic, mean they require energy in order to make larger molecules. So there could be few reaction that are reversible reaction, and few other they are non-reversible reactions. The reversible reactions, they run in both direction. And irreversible reaction, they run from reactant to products only. But reversible reaction, they run from reactant to product, and then they can run from product back to reactant. And in most of the biological reactions, they are reversible, and in one way they are synthetic, and in another way they are the decomposition reaction, mean anabolic and catabolic. The oxidation reduction reactions, collectively they are redox reaction. That is a type of chemical reaction in which the oxidation states of atoms are changed. Redox reactions are characterized by the transfer of electron between atoms or molecules. One of the group is going under oxidation, and another group of molecules is going under reduction. So oxidation is actually the loss of electron or an increase in the oxidation state of an atom. An ion or atoms in a molecule. Reduction, the gain of electron or decrease in the oxidation state of an atom, anion, or of certain atoms in a molecule. So we can define oxidation is gain of oxygen, reduction is loss of oxygen, or oxidation is loss of hydrogen, reduction is gain of hydrogen, or oxidation is loss of electrons, reduction is gain of electrons. So we can define by the electrons, by hydrogen or oxygen. Energy in physics is defined as the ability to do work. So there are different types of energies, like kinetic energy, potential energy, chemical energy, heat energy, and many more. We know the kinetic energy is the property of a substance that is in, or matter that is in motion, and it is due to the state of motion. And potential energy is the energy in a substance or matter due to positioning, its positioning, and could be due to its positioning of, for example, in an atom, it is due to positioning of its electron in the shells. We know there are laws of thermodynamics. They say that the energy cannot be produced and cannot be destroyed, but it can be transferred from one transformed from one form to another form. And this during this transformation of energy, there is loss of energy in the form of heat energy. So we can say heat energy is of type of free energy. So heat energy is actually result of movement of atoms, molecules or ions in matter, and heat energy can be transferred from one object to another. So the chemical energy is type of potential energy, that is potential of a chemical substance to undergo a chemical reaction to transform into other substances. So it is due to positioning of electrons in atoms of that substance. Activation energy is energy which must be provided to a chemical or nuclear system with potential reactants to start a chemical reaction. The catalysts and enzymes, these are the chemicals that decrease this activation energy of the reactants to foster the chemical reaction. So catalysts are the chemical that help in non-living environment to decrease the activation energy, and the catalysts and enzymes, they are recovered, they are not used in conversion of reactant to products, they are not being used, they are recovered after chemical reaction. Enzymes are the chemical that are being used in a living system, and most of the enzymes, they are protein in nature, and there are few RNA, they are called as ribozymes. So the enzymes, they have two main categories on the basis of their composition: protein or RNA. We can say the enzymes, they are biocatalyst that decrease activation energy in living system. In body, there could be inorganic compounds or organic compounds. The inorganic compounds, they include the most of it is water, and others are like oxygen, carbon dioxide, sodium chloride, and many more. So most of them, we know the inorganic compounds, they don't have carbon and hydrogen in their primary structure, while organic compounds, they have carbon and hydrogen in their primary structures. So the carbon dioxide, oxygen, water, sodium chloride, and others, that don't have a carbon and hydrogen in their primary structure, they are inorganic compounds. And the most abundant of it is of them, the inorganic compound is water, and it is very important. We know it is about 65% to 70% of human body, and the chemical reactions, they mostly occur in water. Without water, the cells cannot survive, and we know the water is helping to balance or to maintain body temperature. It helps in protection. For example, we know in case of serous membranes, water is filled between two membranes like pericardial membrane in visceral and the parietal pericardium, there is water. So in other membranes also, so it protects from the physical shocks also. And then it helps in chemical reaction, as we described it previously. It is a best solvent. It is also called as a universal solvent. So if we see in detail, the water maintains the temperature of the body. It cools body, and we know the sweating, and then it lubricates, like in joints, the water is help to lubricate those joints, and the it is helping in hydrolysis, and the used in hydrolysis reaction, that are the catabolic reactions. It helps in cushioning in internal organs, the cavities that are filled with water, for example cerebrospinal fluid. It helps to cushion the brain in order to save from the physical injuries, same as we described previously, that the water is filled in between two layers of serous membrane to protect the vital organs or viscera. And then it is universal solvent. Many compounds, they get dissolved in water. The molecules, the ionic molecules, they get dissociate and ionize. The water, it helps the electrolytes and to convert them into cations and anions, and so that conversion into ions help in membrane transport, muscle contraction, nerve function, for the running action potential, for example the sodium ions, the chloride ion, the potassium ions, the calcium ions, they are present in across the cell membrane due to presence of water. We also know that most of the blood is plasma, so it is helping to transport the compounds like oxygen and food molecules, and in food molecules and others, it is also distinction, making a distinction between hydrophilic and hydrophobic. Hydrophobic, that get don't get dissolved into the water, and hydrophilic, they are dissolved. We can say the hydrophilic, they are polar molecules, and hydrophobic, they are non-polar. So for example, fats and oils, they are non-polar, they don't get dissolved into water, and the hydrophilic, like glucose, electrolytes, sodium chloride, they get dissolved in water, and they, because the ionic compounds, they get dissolved into in water and makes cations and anions. These cations and anions, they help to conduct electric current in body, and these electrolytes, they can only work in presence of water. The key body ions in body are sodium, potassium, chloride, calcium, bicarbonate, and the key electrolytes are sodium chloride, sodium bicarbonate, potassium chloride, sodium chloride, magnesium chloride, calcium chloride. They can only work in presence of water. Mixtures, they are two or more compounds that are mixed up together. There could be heterogeneous mixtures or homogeneous mixtures. In heterogeneous mixtures, the compounds, they are not uniformly mixed together, and they could be tell apart separately. in case of homogeneous mixture, the substances, they are completely mixed and we cannot identify apart each of the component apart. So they are uniformly distributed, everything is dissolved uniformly or mixed uniformly. So solution are homogeneous mixtures, and in this case the solution has two distinct parts, solvent and solutes, that are mixed together, and they are homogeneous mixtures. So for example, sodium chloride is dissolved in water is a homogeneous mixture and it is a solution. In solution, the solute is completely dissolved in the solvent, and the particles, they are minute, so we can see through solution. So solutions are we can say they are transparent. Suspensions are not transparent. We can see bigger particles because the particle sizes are bigger in case of suspension as compared to solution, and they appear to be cloudy when we see through them. If we leave a suspension, the particles, they sit on the bottom, and in case of colloids, the particles are larger than those in solution, but they are smaller than suspension, and these particles, they mostly don't sit still when we leave the colloid. So concentration is a relative term. It is the amount of particular substance contained within a solution or mixture or in a particular volume of space. So concentrations are measured in osmolality, molarity, and normality. So molality is the concentration of a solution expressed as the total number of solute particles per kilogram of the solvent, and molarity indicates the number of moles of solute per liter of solution, and mostly it is used to measure the concentration of solution. A mole of a substance or a mole of particles is equal to 6.02 into 10 raised to power 23 particles. They could be atoms, molecules, ions, or electrons in a substance. That is called as a mole. Normality is measure of concentration, that is the gram equivalent weight of a substance per liter of solution, and the gram equivalent weight is the molecular mass of the substance divided by number of replaceable hydrogen in that. For example, in case of hydrochloric acid, the molecular weight is 36.5 and its replaceable hydrogen is only 1, so it is the 36.5 divided by 1 is equal to 36.5. So the gram equivalent weight of hydrochloric acid is 36.5. So 36.5 gram equivalent weight per liter of solution is called as normality. It would be one normal solution of the hydrochloric acid. The acids are the substances that release hydronium ion into solution after dissociation. So the concentration of hydronium ion determines the acidity. So there could be strong acids there could be weak acids. The strong acids that get dissociate completely in water, for example the hydrochloric acid, it is a strong acid, so it dissolved in, when we put hydrochloric acid in water, there is only hydronium and chloride ion. There would be no hydrochloric acid molecule in water. They are completely dissociated. Not a single molecule of hydrochloric acid would be there. So they are called as strong acid. In case of weak acids, there is, for example, the acetic acid. It is a weak acid. When we dissolve it in water, few of the molecules of acetic acid stay and the others, they are dissociated, and then these dissociated and the complete molecules, they stay in a in an equilibrium. So they are called as weak acid, because all the molecules of acid, they are not dissociated into their ions. So basis, they get hydronium ion from solution, and the or we can say they release hydroxyl ions into solution, and the hydroxyl ion, they determine alkalinity of the solution. So there could be strong bases and there could be weak bases. So the strong bases, they dissociate completely in water to give hydroxyl ion. The weak bases, they again stay in a equilibrium. Few of the molecules, they get dissociate, and few, they are in complete form and they are in equilibrium. For example, the sodium hydroxide is a strong acid, strong base. So when it is dissolved in water, it completely get dissociated into sodium and hydroxyl ions, and there is no complete sodium hydroxide in water. So when an acid and base, they neutralize each other, they make another substance that is called as a salt. So for example, these hydrochloric acid and sodium hydroxide, when they are reacted, there is formation of sodium chloride and water. So sodium chloride is salt here. So they are mostly dehydration reaction, mean water is removed. For example, when we reacted hydrochloric acid and sodium hydroxide, one water molecule is removed. So they are dehydration reaction. The measure of hydronium ion in a solution is pH. We can say amount of hydrogen ion in solution is pH. So it helps to measure acid base concentration in a solution. Most precisely, pH is the logarithmic concentration of hydronium ion in a solution. So there is use of logarithmic scales from 0 to 14. So the substances that are at pH 7, they are called neutral, because they have same number of hydroxyl ion and hydronium ions. The pure water, that is without any salts dissolved in it, minerals, that is called as a neutral. It is at pH 7. And the substances that have pH less than 7, they are acidic. They have more hydronium as compared to hydroxyl ions, so they are acid. And the salts, the substances that have pH greater than 7, they are called basic. They have more hydroxyl ions than hydronium, so we say they are more basic. The pH of blood is 7.35 to 7.45. so we can say it is a slightly alkaline. It is not acidic, it is slightly alkaline. So the hydrogen ions, they must be precisely regulated in body. Presence of too much hydronium ion or hydrogen ion is called as acidosis, and the presence of too much hydroxyl ions is called as alkalosis. So these two conditions they are avoided, and the kidneys and the respiratory system, they help to maintain the acid base balance in body. The buffers, as name shows, they maintain the pH of body fluids, and buffers, they are combination of the weak acids or weak bases, and these weak acids, for example, they are not completely dissociated, they are in incompletely dissociated, and they are maintaining the equilibrium between hydronium and hydroxyl ions. So the reactions, they are reversible, and they help to maintain the pH of body fluid. For example, if it is acetic acid, it is dissociated here, we can see. If the hydronium ions are entering into solution, then these hydronium ions, they can react with this part of molecule and make the acetic acid again, and that acetic acid again dissociate to get equilibrium. And if hydroxyl ions are added, then they can react with hydronium ion to make water, and that is a neutral thing. So the buffers, they can only maintain the pH of solution in a narrow range. Mean if small quantities of hydronium or hydroxyl ions are being entered, they can be managed, but the larger quantities, they cannot be managed by buffers. In blood, there is a carbonic acid bicarbonate buffering system. It is important buffer of blood that keeps the pH of blood in normal range, that we said 7.35 to 7.45. So the carbonic acid, it is dissociated into, because it is a weak acid, so it is dissociated into hydrogen ion and bicarbonate ion in plasma. And when there is rise in plasma pH, that is too much hydroxyl ions are entering into plasma, the reaction goes to right. And the if there is drop in plasma pH, too much hydronium ions are entering into plasma, then reaction goes to left. So we know the inorganic molecule like oxygen, carbon dioxide and hydrogen, they are important in body, and we will see them later on. The organic compounds, they are only present in living systems, or they are only extracted from living system. The organic, they contain both carbon and hydrogen atoms in their structure, primary structure. They also may contain oxygen, nitrogen, sulfur, phosphorus and other elements, and they mostly make long chains of carbon atoms that are linked by covalent bonds. So these are very stable and very large molecules. So the organic compounds, they have functional groups. These functional groups are the chemical groups that determine the properties of organic compounds. So there are three or four types of organic compounds. Like they are carbohydrates that have a functional group, hydroxyl group. They are lipids that have methyl group, proteins that have amino group and carboxylic group, nucleic acids and that have phosphate group, and the nucleic acid, they also include ATPs that have phosphate group. The first macromolecule we are going through is carbohydrate. Carbohydrates are molecules that are made up of carbon, hydrogen and oxygen, and the ratio of hydrogen and oxygen is same as that in water. It means the presence of hydrogen is 2 times as compared to oxygen, and the functional group is in carbohydrates is hydroxyline, hydroxyl group. And the carbohydrates, they are divided into monosaccharides, disaccharides, oligosaccharides and polysaccharides. The monosaccharides, they are the molecules that have 3 carbons to 7 carbons, and these are the smallest unit of carbohydrate, and they start from triose when they have 3 carbons in them to heptoses. And the most important of these monosaccharides are sugars that are the fructoses, glucose and galactose. They are hexoses. They have the 6 carbons in them, but they have a different arrangement of hydrogen and oxygen on their carbon primary structure. So direction, due to directionality, they are also called as structural isomers. And we know carbon dioxide and hydroxyl and hydronium ion as levo or dextro. When a group is directed toward left, it is called levo, and when it is toward right, it is called as dextro. So this is also called as isomerization. The monosaccharides, they are arranged into rings or straight chains. And for example, the glucose, it provide fuel in body, and everything that we consume is when it is used for energy should be converted into glucose, and we can say glucose is the basic source of energy to the body. Disaccharides, they are more complex, and they are, we can say they are double sugar, diamine, two sugars like sucrose, and they are formed by joining two monosaccharides, and it is again a synthesis reaction, that is a dehydration reaction. Water is, when there is formation of a bond, there is release of a water molecule, and when we have to hydrolyze it, we have to add water back here, so the disaccharide would be converted into monosaccharide. And this bond between two monosaccharides is called as glycosidic bond. So the glycosidic bond between glucose and fructose converts it into a disaccharide that is called as a sucrose. The disaccharides, they cannot cross cell membrane. they have to be hydrolyzed into monosaccharide in order to get through cell membrane of a cell for metabolism. In polysaccharides, there are many saccharide, monosaccharide that link together through glycosidic bonds to make polysaccharides. They are long chains of monosaccharides. They are also called as most complex form of the carbohydrate. So the polysaccharides, they are made up, through many synthesis reactions, and the disaccharides, there are many formation of many disaccharides. Then these disaccharides, they again get together through the synthesis reaction, and the glycosidic bonds are formed between these disaccharides to make the larger molecules. And if we have to break it down, then we have to break them first into disaccharides and then into the monosaccharides. So there are many hydrolysis reactions required. And the polysaccharides, the well known, they are glycogen, starch and cellulose in the living system. We know the glycogen is only present in animals and fungi, and starch and cellulose, they are present in the plants, and they are mostly the storage molecules. The polysaccharides are storage molecules. They are for future energy needs and structure of the body in plants and animals and fungi. So we can say the fungi are similar to animals because they store glycogen in them. We can see the cellulose, they are unbranched, and in unbranched form there is a glycosidic bond between one carbon number one of one molecule monosaccharide and carbon number four of the other molecule. So it is 1-4 bonds in cellulose, and it forms a linear structure. So cellulose, they are unbranched, they are linear structure. Glycogen and starch, they are branched. In the glycogen, they are more branched as compared to starch. We can say in starch there are more 1-4 bond than 1-6 bond, so they are less branched. Glycogen, they have more equal number of 1-6 branches and 1-4 branches, so they are 1-6 bond and 1-4 bond, so they are more branched as compared to starch. So what are the functions of carbohydrates? Carbohydrates, as we said, they are source of energy. They produce energy from because they have potential energy in their bonds. When they are broken down, they release that energy, or they can store energy from a chemical reaction and in the form of larger polymers for future use. They also make structures of the cell and the body. They are making markers on cell surface because carbohydrates, they are only present on the outer side of the cell membrane, we'll see later. So they act as markers. Cells can recognize each other through these markers. Similar type of carbohydrate is present on the cell membrane of red blood cells, through which we recognize it, the blood groups, through ABO blood grouping. We'll see it. And then the carbohydrates in animals, they reduce friction. For example, on joints, there are the carbohydrates that absorb water, and they are present in a specific type of connective tissue. And these carbohydrates, they absorb water to reduce friction at the joints, and they also retain water in those connective tissues. They retain water in order to maintain structure of the or shape of the organs. they are part of DNA. We know deoxyribose and ribose sugars, they are part of cell membrane, they are part of cytoskeleton. So lipids are very important polymers present in living organisms, and they make about 10% of body weight of human being. They are very large compounds. They are made up of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, phosphate and nitrogen, and they are non-polar. They are hydrophobic, so they are very very stable. It means they cannot get dissolved in water, because in body there is a lot of water inside the cell and outside of the cell, we saw previously. And the lipids, they are not soluble. They include fats, oils, waxes. Fats is a form of lipid that is in solid state, oils are liquid state, waxes they are hard solid state. So the lipids, they contain carbon and hydrogen in ratio that is 1:2. They have a functional group that is methyl group, CH3. So when the lipids, they are glycerides, they are phospholipids and many more. So if we see them, glycerides are simple lipids. They are like monoglycerides. The glycerides are made up of glycerol and fatty acid. We can see their structure in later slides. So fatty acids are source of stored energy. They are long chain fats, and so they are these long chain carbon containing fats. They are either saturated or unsaturated fatty acid. Saturated fatty acids, they have single covalent bonds, so they are more stable. They are easier to break down and store as fat. And the unsaturated fatty acids, they have double covalent bond in them. They are more stable. And the polyunsaturated fatty acid, they have many double covalent bonds in them. They are very stable and they are best to ingest. So we said glycerides are made up of glycerol plus fatty acid. So a neutral fat is a triglyceride, mean three fatty acids are attached to glycerol. So this triglyceride are fats. They are helping in insulation and protection, and they are source of energy. The phospholipids, they are either glycerophospholipids or they are sphingophospholipids. Glycerophospholipids are made up of phosphatidic acid, mean a glycerol attached with two fatty acid and a phosphate group that is called as a phosphatidic acid. And then this phosphatidic acid is attached with a nitrogen containing sugar. These nitrogen containing sugar in living systems, in cell membrane, they are choline, serine, ethanolamine and inositol. So these are nitrogen containing sugar. So the phospholipids, they may become phosphatidyl choline when phosphatidic acid is attached with a choline. Phosphatidylcholine, phosphatidylserine, phosphatidylethanolamine and phosphatidylinositol. Here we can see fatty acid, and these are the fatty acid. they have carboxylic groups, so they are called as acids, and then there are long chains of carbons. So here it is a stearic acid, that is saturated fatty acid, because it contains all the bonds that are single covalent bonds, so they are called as saturated. And here we have an unsaturated fatty acid, linoleic acid, and it is having few double bonds, so it is a unsaturated fatty acid. And these fatty acid, we can see they are long chains of carbons. And glycerols, they are like this. The methyl groups, they are attached to hydroxyl groups. They are like alcohols. Here we can see glycerol is attached to two fatty acids. These are, they show long chains of carbons. So when a glycerol is reacted with two fatty acids and a phosphate, then this whole structure is called as phosphatidic acid. And then this phosphatidic acid, here we can say here the two fatty acids, they are attached to glycerol, these two fatty acids. And then the glycerol is in backbone. In phospholipids, phosphoglycerolipid, the glycerol is in backbone. So the fatty acids are attached with this backbone, and then phosphate is attached with this backbone to one of the carbon. Two carbons of glycerols are attached with fatty acids, and the rest, the remaining carbon, is attached with a phosphate group. And then with this phosphate group are attached the nitrogenous molecules. These nitrogenous molecules are nitrogenous sugars. They could be choline. So here we can see it is a phosphatidyl choline. It is a phospholipid, phosphatidyl choline. If there is instead of choline it is ethanolamine, then this is phosphatidyl ethanolamine. It could be phosphatidyl serine. It could be phosphatidyl inositol. So in cell membrane we see there are phospholipids. These phospholipids, they have this head that is polar, because there is phosphate group and nitrogenous group. They are more electronegative. They attract electron from the neighboring atoms, so they are polar. They remain toward outer side of the or inner side of the cell membrane. And these legs, they are the two legs of the phospholipids. They are the chains of fatty acid that are not electronegative or positive. They are not attracting charges differently, so the charge distribution is neutral. So they are hydrophobic. So they are nonpolar. They stay toward inner side of the membrane. We'll see them later. Here we can see phosphatidyl inositol. Glycerol is attacked with one of the carbon of glycerol is attacked with phosphate. Two carbons are attacked with two fatty acids, and then here is inositol. It is phosphatidyl. Phosphatidic acid is attacked with inositol. Phosphatidyl inositol. Here it is serine that is attacked with phosphate of the phosphatidic acid, so it is phosphatidyl serine. Here phosphatidic acid, we can see one of the fatty acid attacked with one of the carbon of glycerol, and another fatty acid attacked with the second carbon of the glycerol, and third carbon is attacked with phosphate, and then there is ethanol amine. So this whole structure is called as phosphatidyl ethanolamine, because phosphatidic acid is attacked with ethanolamine, that is a nitrogenous sugar. So these are the four type of phospholipids present in cell membrane or living organism, that is phosphatidyl inositol, phosphatidyl serine, phosphatidyl ethanolamine, phosphatidyl choline. And these phospholipids, they are not only making structure, but they are their metabolites, mean their subunits. When they are metabolized, their subunits can act as chemical messengers that are used in the as a second messenger. We'll see them in later sections. Here is an important phospholipid, that is phosphatidyl bisphosphate. It is a glycerophospholipid because we can see the backbone of the lipid is made up of glycerol, and then there are two fatty acids, and then a phosphate is attacked with this glycerol. So it is a phosphatidic acid. Phosphatidic acid is then attacked with an inositol. So it is phosphatidyl inositol, but this inositol is again attacked with two phosphates. So it is phosphatidyl inositol bisphosphate, that is also called as PIP2, phosphatidyl inositol bisphosphate 2-phosphate. So the phospholipases in cells, these are the enzymes that convert it into diacyl glycerol. Here the bond is between glycerol and phosphate is cleaved, and now it is a glycerol that contains two acyl group, that is the fatty acid long chains of carbon. So it is diacyl glycerol, two acyl groups. So that is also called as DAG. And then an acetol that contains three phosphate, here one phosphate, two phosphate, and three phosphate. So it is an inositol triphosphate, so IP3. So these two chemicals, they are of importance because they act as second messenger in cells. They can open other channels, for example calcium channels and various other. They also can go into the nucleus for transcription of genes. They can stimulate transcriptional factor for the production of those channels. So it is important to understand that these second messengers, they can not only open the existing channels, but they can also increase production of those channels. They can act as transcriptional factor. These second chemical messenger, they can increase transcription of those proteins that are helping to make those channels for the exchange of material. So as we said, the phospholipids are of two types. They are either the glycerophospholipids or they are sphingophospholipids. The glycerophospholipids, as we saw previously, they have backbone of glycerol. In sphingophospholipids, the backbone of the molecules is made up of sphingosine. Sphingosine is actually 2-amino-4-octadecane, mean it is 18 carbon containing sugar, and it contains the OH group at hydroxyl group at 1 and 3 position of the carbon. We will see it later. And when this sphingosine is attacked with the fatty acid, then it is called as ceramide. When there is a phosphocholine and fatty acid attached to sphingosine, then it is called as sphingomyelin. When a single sugar is attacked with sphingosine, then it is called as cerebroside. And when a oligosaccharide, a chain of sugars, is attached with the sphingosine, then it is called as ganglioside. As I said previously, that sphingosine is a 18 carbon long chain alcohol that contain the OH group at the 1 and 3 carbon, and an amino group at second number of carbon. And then if this amino group get attached to a fatty acid, then this whole structure is called as the ceramide. And it is called as sphingolipid because sphingosine is backbone of the molecule. In glycerophospholipid, the backbone was glycerol, and then the rest of the molecule, they get attached to glycerol. In case of sphingolipids, The sphingoseed is the backbone and rest of the molecule get tied to it. For example, here in a sphingomyelin, the amino group of sphingosine is attached with a fatty acid, and the one of the OH group is attached with phosphate, and that phosphate could be linked with a choline, so it is a sphingomyelin that is attached with phosphocholine. So in sphingomyelin, the phosphocholine could be replaced with phosphoethanol amine, it could be inositol, phosphatidyl inositol, it could be serine. So sphingomyelin, and then if inositol get directly attached to the sphingosine backbone without a phosphate, then it is called as a cerebroside. And if multiple sugars or a chain of sugars get attached to the backbone sphingosine, then this whole structure is called as ganglioside. So here we can see the myelin and cerebro and ganglio, they appear as related with the nervous system, because these lipids, they are mostly present in the neurons. They are also isolated from other cell membranes, but their concentration is more in the nervous tissues. So they are given name sphingomyelin, cerebroside and ganglioside. Eicosanoids are the signaling fat molecules that are derived from arachidonic acid or fatty acid like arachidonic acid. Arachidonic acid is also a fatty acid. So these are long chain fatty acids that are made up of 20 carbons. So they undergo oxidation to produce these chemical messengers that are called prostaglandin, leukotriene, thromboxane, and there are many more. So these eicosanoids, they act as hormones. These hormones, they are not endocrine. They are either paracrine or autocrine hormones. There are mostly we can categorize on the basis of the site of action of hormones. These are three types of hormones. Autocrine mean these hormones, they are released, they act on the same cell from which they are being released. Paracrine mean at the periphery, at the neighboring. So these hormones, they act on the neighboring cells of a cell from which they are being released. Endocrine are the hormones that are going into blood, and they are traveling long distances to reach to their targets. So these eicosanoids, they are autocrine or paracrine. So prostaglandin, they are the hormones that are paracrine type of hormones. They are helping in the blood vessels, the dilation of blood vessels. They prevent the clotting within the blood vessels and keep the blood vessel dilated. They also are also helping in the reproductive system, and they are the leukotriene. They are eicosanoids that are released by leukocytes in order to tell these leukocytes or charge the leukocytes for, to reach to a site of infection. We know the leukocytes are the cells, are white blood cells. They can get out of the blood vessels from the capillaries into the tissues where there is infection, and they are chemically attracted by those infection. So these white blood cells that get exposed to an infection first, they release chemical signal in the form of leukotriene to tell other white blood cell to reach at the site of the infection. Thromboxanes are released by the thrombocytes, the platelets, to reach to the site of injury. So again, the platelets that first reach to the site of injury, they release thrombocytes to tell other platelets to reach over the site of injury to make a plug in order to prevent the loss of blood. So these are the all are icosamide. Steroids are the of many types, and they perform a lot of function. They are formed from cholesterol, and cholesterol itself is a steroid, and they are the cholesterol, they are maintaining cell membrane structure, and they are also providing hormones, and the steroid hormone and the bile salt. So bile salt help in digestion of lipid and dietary fats, and the hormones, we know there are like hormones that are released from the gonads, that are the sex hormone, estrogen, testosterone, and then we have the hormones that are released from the adrenal medulla, that are aldosterone, cortisol, that is also called as glucocorticoid. So aldosterone help to regulate the sodium in the plasma at kidneys, and the cortisols, they are anti-inflammatory, they are also helping in fight and flight. And then there are certain the androgen that are released from the adrenal cortex. So these all are derived from cholesterol, so they are called as steroid hormones. Steroid hormones, because they are lipid in nature, so they cannot be stored in the glands. They are formed when they are needed. Cholesterol is present in those glands, and when it is needed, they are formed. They are also not water soluble, so they cannot travel in, because steroid hormones, they are endocrine, mean they have to go into blood and travel along a lot of distances to get to their target. So these steroids, they need special type of carriers in order to get transport in blood, because they are water insoluble. So some vitamins are also fat in nature, and they are A, D, E, and K vitamin. A vitamin is an organic molecule that is a micronutrient, and the organism, they need in small quantities in order to perform function. The vitamins, so broadly, vitamins, they can function as coenzymes, the organic compounds that help enzymes to perform their function. We know the cofactors, they are non-organic, but vitamins are, because they are organic, so they are coenzyme. So the vitamin, they are helping enzymes to perform their function, and they also function as antioxidants. They prevent damage from free radicals in body. Free radicals are the ions that can damage all type of molecules in body, macromolecules like fats, nucleic acid, proteins, and carbohydrates. They are attacked by free radicals. So the few of the vitamins, they are acting as the predator of these free radicals to prevent damage to the structure of the body. Then vitamins, they also act as chemical messengers. For example, vitamin D is a chemical messenger. It is working as a hormone also. So the vitamins, we can say broadly, they are working as coenzymes, they are working as antioxidant, they are working as chemical messengers or hormones. So the vitamins that are soluble in lipids, or they are made up of lipids, they are A, D, E and K. As we saw, the simple fat or neutral fats, they are triglyceride, glycerol and attached with fatty acids. So this with three fatty acids. So this triglyceride is a simple fat. So these fats, they are protecting organs. They are helping in the insulation in the body for the maintenance of temperature. They are also being used as a storage product, and the fats can be utilized in future. They are also helping in regulation and coordination. We saw the phospholipid, that is phosphatidyl inositol, phosphatidyl choline, phosphatidyl serine, phosphatidyl ethanolamine. They may, or their products, their metabolites, they can act as chemical messengers. We'll see them later on, and we can say they are intracellular chemical messengers. And they are also making structure. For example, phospholipids, they are glycerophospholipids and the sphingophospholipids. They are making the structure of the cell membrane, and then hence the whole structure of the whole body. They are also the fats. They are storing energy. They are providing energy. These fats, lipids, they are also in the form of vitamins. They are also working in the form of hormones and regulating the function of cell enzymes, and they are antioxidant, they are coenzymes, they are hormones. Then we have proteins. We are very familiar with proteins. We know they are made up of amino acids. The structural unit of protein is amino acid. An amino acid is a molecule that has an amine group and a carboxylic group as a functional groups. So these amino acids, they get together by a peptide bond, and this peptide bond makes a linear structure of the amino acid. That linear structure is called as a primary structures of protein. And the proteins, they could be dipeptide, they could be polypeptide. And if the linear chain get fold on it, then this structure, and then there is hydrogen bond between the two sides of the chain, then this structure is called as a secondary two-dimensional. So it is called as a secondary structure. When a single chain is folded on itself, then it is called as a tertiary structure, when it attains a three-dimensional structure. And when two different chains of proteins, they come together and they make a hydrogen bond between them, then it is called as a quaternary structure. Like lipids, proteins could be functional, they could be structural. Structural proteins, they are present in cell membrane and they make muscles and many other. And functional proteins, that are like enzymes, they are biocatalysts. They are proteins, then there are channels, there are transporters, there are the pumps. In cell membrane, we will see them later. So the enzymes here are the biocatalysts. They may require inorganic compounds to function. These inorganic compounds are called as cofactors. And if they require the organic compounds, then these organic compounds are called as coenzymes. And then the functions of proteins are, again, a lot of functions. They help in the proteins, they are also in the form of the hormones, like protein hormones, growth hormone, insulin. They all are protein or peptide hormones. And so they help in regulation. The proteins are helping in regulation in the form of chemical messenger, in the form of coordination. And they are also helping in transport of material. We know the proteins, they are making the cytoskeleton, that are the microtubules and microfilaments and intermediate filaments. And then in muscles, they are making the actin and myosin proteins. So these are helping in transport of the material within the cell, of the whole body or within body. And then the protein, they are also protecting. They are in the form of the antibodies. They are protecting the they are making a defense system of the body. The antibodies, they are called as immunoglobulin protein. They are made up of globular protein. And then they are helping in contraction. We know the muscles, they are contracting. And then they are making structure. We saw the muscles and these protein present on cell membranes. And then the proteins, they may be used as energy, the last source of energy. When there is no energy in body, then it may use. The first source is sugars, the glucose, and then the glycogen, and then lipids. And then if still energy is deficient, then it can be extracted from the proteins in muscles. Another function of the protein is in the form of mucus. Mucus is a protein, glycoprotein, that is released by the goblet cells in respiratory system, digestive system, reproductive system. In the these cells, they are present in the internal lining of the tubes, and they release that glycoprotein that make a soapy layer on these tube, on the surface of these tubes, in order to protect from various hazards, chemical, microbial hazards. Then we have nucleic acid. We are again very familiar with these nucleic acid. They are made up of sugar, a phosphate, and a nitrogenous base. So we know the nitrogenous bases are thymine, adenine, guanine, cytosine, and uracil. And there are two type of polymers: DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid, and RNA, ribonucleic acid. It is on the basis of the type of sugar present in these molecules. For example, deoxyribonucleic acid has deoxyribose sugar, and the ribonucleic acid has ribose sugar. We know DNA is genetic blueprint for protein. In they are present in nucleus in case of eukaryotic organisms, and they contain our genetic code. And the RNA, they carries DNA instruction for protein synthesis from nucleus into cytoplasm. And the broadly, we can say the nucleic acids, they store and process molecular information in cells. They regulate all aspects of cellular metabolism. They determine inherited characters, genetic traits. They store information that is needed to build body proteins. They have genetic code for protein synthesis. So we have another molecule, that is ATP. They are also called as high energy compounds, that is ATP, ADP, and AMP. ATP is a nucleotide, that is adenine triphosphate. ADP is adenine diphosphate, and the weakest is adenine monophosphate, AMP. So they are important because they are being used by cell as a energy currency. And cell, they can store these ATP for a fraction of time because they are very hydrolytic. I mean, when these ATP they come in contact with water, they are hydrolyzed, so they cannot stay for longer time. And the cells, they extract energy by Krebs cycles and glycolysis and electron transport chain, and then embed this energy in the form of ATP, and that energy is, we can say, in the form of potential energy. So later on, these ATPs, they are being used for different function in order to charge other proteins and molecules. AMP, adenosine monophosphate, it has one phosphate, so it has the least energy. And ADP has intermediate energy because it has two phosphates, and the ATP, it has the most energy, and because it has three phosphate groups. And it, for example, in mechanical and chemical works, it provides energy. For example, the muscular contraction is a mechanical work that is supported by ATP, and then chemical works in various chemical reactions to form new molecules that are the anabolic reactions, they are being supported by ATP in the body.